Glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, and for as many years as we have seen evil. Let your work be shown to your servants, and your glorious power to their children. Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish the work of our hands upon us. Yes, establish the work of our hands.
It's a privilege to be able to pray during the service. One of the things, Jim was an encourager to the pastoral staff here at Heritage, and whenever he saw me, and he saw my wife, and he says Sister Bill and others, but he would always say, pray for you every day. And so it's with great thanks and gratitude that I can pray now for the family and for Jim. He was a big encourager to all of us here. Let's pray. God, we thank you for the life and testimony of Jim. He was a man who loved you. He loved you and he loved the work of the church. He loved missions. He loved the people of the church. He loved people outside of the church, and that he wanted them to come to have a knowledge of saving faith in Christ. He shared the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ in the hospital room days before his homecoming. And he was excited to talk about the living hope. And so, God, we rejoice that he is with you. We rejoice in his life and his testimony. We rejoice in his family, the sons, the grandsons, granddaughters, his wife, the testimony, their faithfulness to you. God, we rejoice in your faithfulness to him. And God, it is a joy to know that Jim is united with you. And God, it's a testimony to me, it's a testimony to many here tonight, that he had great hope and he had great peace. It's because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ and your faithfulness to your word and your promise. So God, we lift up you tonight. We lift up Jim. We pray for the family. We pray that you would encourage, that you would strengthen, and that you would pass on the baton that Jim has so faithfully carried on behalf of his family and his love for you to the next generation that follow behind him. God, we do praise you tonight for the life and the ministry of Jim Hirdes. And it's in Christ's name that we can have this confidence. Amen.
So thank you for the peace of God, the peace with God that we can have because of our relationship with Jesus Christ. And ultimately, Jim has that ultimate peace in heaven right now. One of his favorite songs was the song Wonderful Peace. Peace, peace, wonderful peace coming down from the Father. But let's sing this hymn together, please.
At this time, we're going to have some family members going to come and share. Do you have the correct order of who's going first? David, it looks like you.
Alrighty, so bear with me because I have a lot of random notes, obviously, when this happens. You stay up late and go through it. So I'm going to try to do the best to make sense of what I was thinking. But when you think of grandpa, you think of a word or some words that come to mind. So what I'm going to do is an acrostic. I did this with the other grandma that passed away earlier, Nina. So I'm going to do another acrostic. I'm probably going to keep doing the acrostics because I have another one of these in a couple days. But I'm not going to do, so Jim spelled J-I-M, but if you know me and my dad, we can't spell, so we're going to do G-I-M, so like basketball Jim slash his name Jim. So, the first letter is G, not J, even though it was J. G stands, there's two words that come to mind when you think of G. One, you think of gigantic, and the other word is gentle. But we're going to start with gigantic personality. If you knew Grandpa, he had a gigantic personality. He was super enthusiastic. He always wanted to greet you with a hug, know how you were doing. He always was a, when he greeted people at church, when he was standing there and greeted you, yeah, he gave you, hey, how are you doing, whatever. But when he saw his grandkids, it was a different level. And he loved his grandkids. He loved each and every one of us. And he always was a great encourager as well. He always wanted to make sure that we were taken care of. Whatever we needed, it'll work out, it'll be okay, what do you need, how can I help you? He always wanted us to come over to his house for lunch, and if we went over there for lunch, he always wanted us to take things with us. So go to the refrigerator, get a couple drinks to go, make sure you get some candy to go. Whatever he wanted, he was always there. He always wanted to make sure his grandkids were taken care of, and that was something that was always very precious to us. And if something, if you were down or something wasn't right, he would say, keep going, you got it. Always was a great encourager. So his personality was gigantic in every way, shape, or form. But the second G, two words that come to mind, is gentle. And you wouldn't think of Grandpa being gentle, but he was very gentle in his spirit when it came to talking with you. He was always, would want you to come over, like I said originally, but he always wanted to know what was going on in your life. He always wanted to talk with you and say, hey, what's new? What can I talk with you about? And so he would call me all the time. When I wasn't here, he'd always call me in Chicago on my birthday or whenever and just catch up with me. Catch up and see, how are you doing? What's new in your life? Wanted to know about the ministry I was involved in, what's going on, how could he pray for me, and always cared so much. He had a gentle, calming spirit, and I think that was super precious. And then also, I don't know if my dad's going to share this, but he always wanted to make sure you had a good car. I don't know what that was, but I don't know if Jeff Stone's here. I don't think he is, but he, would promote Jeff Stone really hard, so, Jeff should be, thankful, because he was like, go get your car repaired there. Make sure it's taken care of. I think we've all had an issue with Grandpa and cars when it comes to, what kind of car? And then he wants me, is it still running? Is it okay? Does it need tires? How are your tires? Does it have the oil change? I mean, he always cared that you were taken care of, and I guess cars was the one way to make sure that if you had a good car, you were in good shape. So whatever the case is there. The I. So we'll go back to the original spelling of his name, I. Incredible. And incredible in the sense of it goes along with gentle and gigantic in a sense, but he would always want to come to everything we were involved in. So for me, playing basketball or sports, he wanted to come to every single game. And then when I moved back down and I was coaching, he's like, what game can I come to? What game can I, what's close for me that I can sit in and gym access and I can get inside? He wanted to know what was going on in our lives. He wanted to come to our sporting events, recitals, whatever it was. He was there supporting us. And that was the coolest thing. He would also go with Joel to baseball games. Joel, I met you many times. He would go spring training. He would call up Regal Honda in cars, and he would get free tickets somehow. And he would be taking Joel, and they'd be, you were out of school. So, I don't know, just being able to go for a Sunday or mid-afternoon game, spring training game. He loved doing that. He loved going to sporting events. But anything he could do with his grandkids, he loved that more than anything. He always wanted the best for us. He wanted what we need. When he called always asks this question to me specifically because I was late getting married. But he always said, okay, so he said, so is there any sweetheart in your life? And I'd be like, no, I haven't met anybody. No, there's nobody there. And he was like, well, don't just be patient. The right one's out there. You'll find the right one. And like he always said that. He always wanted to know. And so then he would always, then the second question to ask is if there was a sweetheart, he wanted to make sure I had somebody to take care of me or love me or whatever. But then he also wanted, when are you coming home? When can I see you? When can I get to hang out with you? Or when? And then the second question is, are you moving back? Have you thought about moving back? No, I'm not there yet, Grandpa. I'm still up here. This is where God's calling me. When are you moving back? And I know we've all done that. Like, when can you come? When can you come over to eat lunch? When can you come see me? Or, he just wanted to be able to be with his grandkids. And I think that was a huge, huge thing. And so the last letter, so we went through G, I, and then M is Mary. Now, obviously, it goes with the season, the Christmas season. But he was married. He was very joyful. He always tried to find something. Believe it or not, yeah, if you knew Grandpa, he wanted to know everything about your grandkids, and then he wanted to make sure he found something positive in the situation, and then he wanted to share. Like, if you all probably know more about me than I know about myself, because he's told you all everything. If you know Grandpa, he's told you about each one of his grandkids, I guarantee you. You know something about me that I probably don't even know, and or it might be made up, but that's beside the point. But he loved his grandkids, so he always talked about us constantly. But then he always found something positive. So, for example, cable TV in the hospital was the greatest thing ever. We got 45 or 100 channels now or something like that. Or we got a big room. And so when they came up and visited me in Chicago, and that was the best thing ever. He wanted to see everywhere I lived, what ministries I did. He wanted to visit everywhere. We're in the middle of the west side of Chicago, which is not the best area. He's stumbling out of the car there. Hello, how's it going? And you've got not so great people walking by. It's just a different way of life up there. But he's talking to everybody, wants to know about it. And he's like, well, how's your room? Or how's your hotel room? Oh, it's great. It's got a big sofa or a big bed. It's awesome. It's the perfect room. We got a great deal on it. And that was him. He always found the positive in everything. And so then, he loved his grandkids. But then when I finally found Grace, and I finally found my wife, and when Joel finally found Katrina, it was like, so he loved us, and then when you found your spouse, it was like a different level. So it's like your kids, great, your grandkids even better, and then when you found your spouse, like, once I found somebody, it was the greatest thing, but when he found Grace, he loved us. He loved Katrina, he loved each and everyone, TJ and Chase and Josh, all of us. He loved us so tremendously because we were a part of his family, and he wanted to make sure we were taken care of, and that we were able to spend time with him at Christmas, or spend time with him on the holidays, or get to see him whenever. Come on over, eat a burger. Mom will cook you a burger. That's what I said. Mom will cook you a burger. Or grandma. But he always called her mom. He was very joyful in all of it. One of the funny stories, so we always, speaking of the Christmas time, this is one thing we even did it last year. So he always sat in his chair. He sat in his chair, and then we would sing Gloria. Believe it or not, he doesn't know any of the words of the song, so I don't know why we sang all the words. He only knew Gloria. Like, he would but he never knew the words. So my mom would be the one trying to sing all the words. The rest of us were like, just laughing at him. But we would always, so he would sit in his chair, in his big chair, and once we got older, we always would have paper fights. We ripped open our presents. Grandma passed away with our paper fights. Well, my dad had the right idea. Let's just see if we can pop it right on his belly and get him all riled up. So sure enough, we would sit across the room and just throw it in the land, right on his stomach. He'd go, whatever. If you knew him, you'd just get all riled up. We thought it was the funniest thing. So then, we took it to another level, and we get candy. Grandma gives us candy. Well, one year she didn't put it in an individual baggie. She just dumped it in our stockings. And so we took the candy and we started chunking it at each other. So then I started getting at Grandpa. He got all flustered and riled up. But he always loved it, ultimately loved it. But he would always get flustered and riled up. And that, we love to do that because we love to see him just get going. And it was always so much fun. He was always merry. He was always joyful. I think at the end, I think what he wants us to take away is obviously we don't have to be sad. We don't have to. We can miss him and miss his presence here because with God forever. And he would want us as a family just to remember that he loved us tremendously, but then also that Jesus loves us, and that he loved us because Jesus loves us more. And because of that, we can rejoice and have hope, knowing so full that he's with him. And so I think that's it. G for gigantic, gentle, I for incredible, and M for Mary, I think would sum up Grandpa very well. Thank you.
We sang the song, Peace, Peace, Wonderful Peace. Well, it was my lot in life, and I passed it on to my son to make sure there was never any peace in our house. And I'm not sure why that was his favorite song, because as soon as I got there, I made sure there was no peace. And one way or another, I'd get my brother, and that wasn't my brother, that was my son. People get that confused. My brother's sitting down there. And I'd always get dad mad at my brother, which was, I just loved doing that. But I was going to share just a few things about my dad and his ministry in my life, but what I could never figure out for as long as I was alive is how my dad and my mom got together. That blows my mind. You have my mom, who is shy and quiet, can play any instrument, the cello, the violin, the piano, the organ, the pipe organ, she can play anything. And my dad can't even play the radio. And all he was sports and ball games. It wasn't until I got married that I knew there was anything else on TV besides sports. And that's all we ever watched. And then my mom was just fine arts and completely in that arena. And somehow they got together and it worked. And I've never been able to figure that out. But one thing I know, my dad loved my mom. What an example that was. He just loved her. And always, you know, anytime he wanted something, or if I was misbehaving, the first thing is, you're disappointing your mother. I got that figured out. But how the two of them ever got together, and it just worked. Just polar opposites. And I was told that before I was born, my parents had a dog. And then I was born, they got rid of the dog. And then I got married to my wife, it's a good thing. And as soon as I got married, they got another dog. And I don't know where that leaves me, but I guess I was kind of just the dog of the family. And that is a true story, isn't it? Yeah, she doesn't know what to say. She told me before, she goes, I just want it to be long, don't be real short. I said, nobody's ever told me that before. And my parents are from Michigan, and that's where I'm from as well. And I can remember, I was with them, I can remember as a little kid in Michigan, in maybe 3-4 years old, and I would go down to the end of the street and wait for my dad to get home, then I'd jump in his lap and drive the car, the house or two home. I remember going to the end of the street and standing in the middle of the road, and he'd come to a stop, and I'd jump in the car. Well, one day, he went to stop, and he didn't stop. And I remember vividly as a kid going, he's going to run over me. And so I jumped out of the way, and it was snowing, and he comes and gets me, and he goes, what are you doing? There was ice in the road. I couldn't stop. I said, well, I know, but why didn't you stop? And he goes, there was ice in the road, I couldn't stop. And I said, I know, but why didn't you stop? And because I just thought in my mind, my dad could do anything. And he could stop. And I remember him pulling me out of the snow and getting in the car. And he said, don't do that again. And then it was, I don't know, sometime they decided to move to Florida. And I caused them to move to Florida, too. This is, everything I'm telling you is true. Now, my mom's going to be real embarrassed, but that's okay. She's the one that made me come up here. But when I was 3 or 4 years old, I robbed a house across the street. It's a true story. I broke in, messed up the house. I did finger paints everywhere, everything. And so it was either I was going to prison or they had to leave the state. Not really that part, but I really did go into the house across the street. And messed it all up. I remember my dad just telling me,
parents went in there. And so shortly after that, they moved to Florida. And my dad always said he moved to Lakeland because it was a spring training home for the Detroit Tigers. And he wanted to come down here and watch baseball. And what I also didn't tell you, and explain a lot the way that I am, is I come from a broken home. And I know that shocks many of you. Literally, I come from a broken home. When we pulled into Florida in the Skyview Drive, our house that my parents had bought was in two pieces. There was the right piece and the left piece. It was a mobile home. And I just looked at my, I remember looking at my dad going, oh, that's so cool. What side do I get to live in? And he was like, oh, I can't believe it's not put together. It's supposed to be up in a lot. Do you remember that, Mom? When we pulled in there? And that's affected me deeply. And so I remember we had to move one street over. We stayed in a temporary mobile home. And we weren't down here very long, and there was a hurricane that came through. And my dad, and he's yelling at me. And he said, don't open the door. Don't open the door. Guess what I did? I opened the door. Next thing you know, the door is ripped off the hinges, and it's bouncing down the ninth fairway. So I'm standing there in the doorway, and my dad goes, close the door. I'm like, there's no door. I knew what you opened the door for, and I just, Jim did it. And that got me out of everything. And then we played Little League Baseball. And I remember he was the coach of my Little League team, and I played with my brother. We played on a baseball team called Plumbers Local 624. And my dad was the coach, and I was probably a little too young to play. Matter of fact, I must have been short because his name for me was Shorty. And he stuck me out in right field. And nobody ever hits the ball in right field. And the only time you do anything in right field, the first baseman can't catch it, so you have to go get it. And I'm standing out there, and I was like, go get the ball. I was like, he missed it, let him go get it. And I remember standing out there in right field, and my dad yelling at me, look alive, look alive. I never knew what that meant. And I looked dead. And then it was boring out there, so I decided I wanted to play catcher. But I was scared of the ball. And that's not a good thing for a catcher. And so I would, every time they throw me the ball, I'd turn around. So my dad takes me in the backyard, and he starts throwing baseballs at me with all my catching gear on. I kept turning around and getting hit by them, and they hurt. And he says, don't turn around. I kept turning around, and he's just throwing baseballs at me. And I remember my mom going out there, and she goes, what are you doing? He goes, I'm teaching him not to turn around. And I'm getting built up. If I stood in the front, I'd be fine, because I had my chest gear, my knee pads. And my mom goes, quit doing that to that poor kid. So my dad, I remember him throwing baseballs at me. And I remember my dad as our coach. About that time, he also started umpiring. And at some point in there, he cut his finger off. And then they sewed it back out, and they sewed it on crooked. So I could always tell my dad when he was calling behind the plate, when he put his finger out there, because it was crooked. It's to call a strike. And it was very obvious to him, but I remember when that happened, came home, and Mom told us, your dad cut his finger off. Wow, that's cool. And he had it put back on, but it was always crooked. And I remember going to many baseball games. My dad loved baseball. We were at a Detroit Tigers baseball game. And I was there with my grandpa Patel and my brother. I don't know if you remember this. And we were walking out back in the 70s, and a streaker jumped over the fence. And he runs to second base, and then he runs out, and I'm just looking with my eyes big. You remember that, Jim? And my dad just looks down at me, and he goes, you know what that was? And he goes, that's an idiot. And then we just walked out. I thought, wow, okay. And I remember the many vacations we had as a family. Very special times. My entire goal was to see how mad I could get my dad in the car. And I accomplished that goal most of the time. We would be driving either back to Michigan or someplace. And I was a light sleeper, and I could hear my mom and dad saying,
sleeping in the back, and we've just passed the last, we just passed the rest stop. We're good to go. As soon as I heard that, I went to my brother and said, hey, don't you gotta go to the bathroom? And he looked, and he'd say, oh yeah, hey Dad, can we stop? Oh man, I knew it. And that was just great. And then he would be the one that got in trouble. I remember one time we went down to the Keys. We were on the way to the Keys. And he had talked about it for weeks that we were going on Wooten's airboat tour in the Everglades. It's a big airboat. And we were going to ride as a family. And I remember it stunk. It was hot. They had half-dead animals there. We were going through a swamp. I was like, who would like this? The mosquitoes were incredible. And we got done with it. 25 years later, I took my boys. They're going to ride. And it was the same thing. They had the same half-dead animals, the same swamp. It was mosquito-ridden. The airboat was hot. And they're probably going to take their kids one day when they have kids. And I tell you, my boys are married, but that is great. And I remember going out to eat, and we'd go to Ponderosa Steakhouse. And they had this buffet, and I would be going through there and pulling something off, and he'd put it back on. I'd pull off that green Jell-O, and he'd put it back on. No, that's $2, you're not getting that. And I'd pull off the dessert, we'd get that at home, put it back on. Well, we'd get to the end, and I'd get my little hamburger and go sit. And I remember the one time I went through, and I said, the lady goes, what can I get you? And I said, I'd like a steak. And I get through the end, I didn't pull anything off, and next thing you know, she's bringing me a steak, and my dad about hit the roof. That's the last time we went out there. And I can, right after, one of the joys my dad had when David touched on was he was always concerned about our cars. And the last time my wife wrecked a car, we had to get a new one. And she did. And she totaled it. And so my dad, he goes, you gotta get a car. And so we found one. He spent the entire day down at the dealership, beating them down in price. And they kept saying, well, is your son gonna come down? No, he's working, he can't be here. He's out ministering. And they said, well, maybe he wants to take it for a test drive. Nah, he's fine. And he was there all day long. And I remember my mom saying, well, a couple times when the shouting started, you wanted to leave. But he just stayed at it the whole time until he got the deal. And then all I had to do was walk in and sign the paper, and we were able to get a car. And he loved doing that. And one of the last conversations I had with him was, I mentioned months before, I said, yeah, sometime I'd like a truck. Okay, what kind of truck do you want? I'll start calling dealerships. And I said, well, I just got a few problems. One's I don't have any money. And he goes, it doesn't matter, I'll start calling him. So he starts calling dealerships around Central Florida. And my son's going to come in, he's a missionary, you need to take care of him. And I thought, well, Dad, if that gives you something to do, just call all the dealerships. And the last one he called was Wesley Chapel Honda. I was supposed to be there last week. And I can remember when one of the funniest times I had with David and Joel were over there, and they were begging for something. And this wasn't that long ago, and Grandpa's saying, no, no. And then finally he's like, come on. And so they went and asked Grandma, and my dad goes, no. And my mom looked just a stern face, and she looks right at my dad and goes, who made you Grandma? And I'll never forget that. But he always loved his kids. He loved his grandkids. He loved us unconditionally. He loved everything about us. I mean, he loved where we worked, what we did. He was our biggest promoter. He was my biggest sales force in ministry and what we were doing. And I remember that my dad was such a godly man. Always had the Bible open. Matter of fact, it didn't matter what house we lived in as kids, it was always sitting there. When he got up early, he read the Bible. And the verse that comes to mind is Proverbs 23:26. My son, give me your heart, and let your eyes observe my ways. And that was my dad. Just follow what I'm doing. Just follow me. And he was such a great example to me. And the joke in my house between my mom and David and Joel, and they're always telling me, "You're just like your father." Well, that's the greatest compliment I could ever get. We need more Jim Hirdeses in this world. He was an incredible man. And I wish I could be more like my father. Proverbs 17:6. Grandchildren are the crown of the aged, and the glory of children is their father. And he loved his grandchildren. And one day I'll probably love to look my grandchildren. Where's David and Joel? But he loved his grandchildren. And boy, he loved to brag about them. And 3 John, verse 1-4, was just his heartbeat. "I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth." And that was my dad's life, that we walked in the truth. And I've just got one final thing to do before I turn it over. And if any of you knew my dad, this will make perfect sense. He's finished. He is in heaven. He's finished a race. He's scored. He was a referee for 40 years. And he finished the race. He finished it strong. And it's a touchdown.
Say about you now. I'm just kidding. Jim was an interesting guy. He would talk about you guys all the time. One thing that was underneath everything you didn't use the word was loyalty, incredible loyalty. Loyalty to the Tigers when they stunk, which has been often. But loyalty to you guys. Unbelievable. No matter what you did, he was your biggest supporter. So loyal, showed it in different ways, knew more information about other people than any person I knew. I mean, if I wanted to know what's going on in the church, I asked him, I didn't ask anyone else. "Hey, Jim, what's going on?" "Well, I'll tell you what's going on, you know." And I don't know where this came from, but his idea of personal space was like an inch. And so, like, he'd get right up and talk to you, like here, you know, like, to keep coming back. And if anyone else wanted to talk to you, he'd box them out. Really good. He was really good at it, basketball background or something. But he was loyal to me. I'm sure he was loyal to you, J.O. He was loyal to the church. The last time I talked on the phone in the hospital, he wanted someone to run up little carts to him that had service times on them because he's giving them out to everybody. "And I need my friend out of those carts." "Here, can we see these little carts? Right? Could you get those carts up to me?" I said, "Well, Jim, you have COVID." But it didn't matter. He wanted that. He was loyal to his kids. Whether I saw you or not, he didn't have to. He told me everything about you. So, Jim and Linda, I've been seeing you guys forever, and I don't have to. I know everything that's gone on in your life. He's told me everything about you, the grandkids, everything. And I really enjoyed talking to him. Every week, we'd come up, and when I'd walk in here, he'd say, "Hey, preacher, come out over here." And it'd be like 3 new families that were here. "You gotta meet this guy, you gotta meet this person, you gotta talk to them." "Who are they?" "Oh, I told you the best preacher in the world." He probably said that about you too. He's probably said about every preacher. But anyway, I took it all in. It was good. But what was really about Jim, and Scott said near the end, was really his love for Christ. He really had a love for the Lord. He had a love for the work of the Lord. If you love the Lord, you love his work. That's how it works, right? You don't love the Lord and hate what he does. If you love the Lord, you love his work. If you love the Lord, you love his church. If you love the Lord, you love missions. And those are things he loved because he loved the Lord. If you love the Lord, you love your wife. If you love the Lord, you love your kids. You love your family. And Jim loved the Lord. And there was a passage of scripture, Dan read it, that my mind was drawn to when Jim passed. And by the way, one of the things that we said, Jim loved his kids. No, Jim loves his kids. It's not past tense. He loves you. He loves you now. One of the comforts of my heart, and Jim would always say to me too, is he said to David, I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you all the time. I'm praying for you. His loyalty to the church would sound like this. You know, I passed 379 churches on the way to church today. But I passed them all because I wanted to be here. Right? That's kind of how he was. Really committed. But he always prayed, and he prayed for you. He didn't just pray for you in the past. He's praying for you still. He's just got a better seat. Okay? Praying is asking the Lord, right? I can imagine he's asking the Lord right now for certain things about y'all. And so that doesn't stop. I think sometimes we think, oh, they died, they're not praying anymore. Where do we get that idea? With the Lord. They get personal time with the Lord. They can talk to him. And so I'm sure he still is. But this psalm is unique. Dan read it earlier. It's a psalm, the only psalm that Moses wrote. It's the oldest psalm in the Psalter. It's the beginning of book 4 in the Psalter. Book 4 is by the way, each book has to do with reflecting the Pentateuch. So this really is the book of wanderings. And so if you remember what happened in the book of wanderings, the members that were wandering around, and they wandered around for everyone to die. And everyone died. And so this doesn't surprise us that this psalm would kick off the fourth book of the Psalms, because it's talking about death. We know about Moses. He spent 40 years in Pharaoh's home. Then he spent 40 years in the backside of the desert. Then he spent 40 years in the wilderness. That's kind of how you divide his life. And he's writing late in his life as he's meditating on the wanderings that they went through in the desert. And one thing that stuck out to him about that was just watching people die. And there are three stanzas in the psalm. Verses 1 through 6 is a stanza, verses 7 to 11 is a stanza, and then verses 12 to 17 is a stanza. Isaac watched beast his hymn, our God in help in ages past on this psalm. And there's just a couple things I want to say in light of why we're here tonight. One of them is just realizing that life is brief. Now, is 82 years brief? It is when you're 82. Right? Some of you can remember when you thought 40 years was like one foot in the banana peel and the other in the grave. Remember that? When you thought you're just about ready to die at 40. And now all of a sudden, that looks real good right now. And so life is brief. You wake up one day and you're however old you are now. Right, Gloria? You wake up one day, how did I get here? And it seems brief. We see in these verses, the beginning, it talks about the timelessness of God. Now it talks about the tyranny of the tomb. That as we live, we have this tyranny of the tomb. And we're all facing it, right? And now Jim, for the last 5 years, has been dying next week. Right? So when he told me on the phone last week that he was dying, I didn't believe him. I don't believe him. Well, I think I'm really going this time, preacher. No, you're not. Come on. You just keep on ticking, you know? And then finally it was God's time to call him home. As a matter of fact, in verse 4, as Dan read, it says, 1,000 years are like yesterday. And then he says, they're like a watch in the night. Now, 1,000 years being like yesterday would be a day, but a watch in the night is just, there are four watches, so it's 3 hours. So 1,000 years to the Lord is like 3 hours, which would mean like a day is like, what, 333 years. God just encompasses time. By the way, if you want to work it all the way down, it would make a second in God's time. It's just giving an illustration, but if you want to break down, it would be 35 days. But we know God's not bound by time. It's kind of an anthropomorphic way of saying that time is very short. What is your life? James says. It's like a rot, a vapor. It appears for a little time, and then what? It's gone. It's gone. And Job said, my days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle. And so, the time passes swiftly. The tyranny of the tomb. And then we see the brevity of life. It's just short. It's really, really short. What happens when life's over? When we no longer breathe anymore, it's called death, right? What is death? Jim died. What is that? The word
separated from our body, that would be physical death. And then there's a separation of being separated from our God, that would be spiritual death. We're all born spiritually dead. It means we're all born separated from God. Then when we're born again, we're born spiritually, but we still have to face that separation from our body, right? But we do know this, to be absent from the body, separate death, is to be what? Present with the Lord. And so 2 Corinthians, Paul unmasks that. Says, it is kind of mysterious. It still is the last enemy, the scripture says. It's been ultimately defeated by Jesus, but it is departure from the body. John Bunyan said this in his deathbed, don't weep for me, but for yourselves. I go to the Father with the Lord Jesus, who no doubt will receive me, though a sinner, through the mediation of our Lord Jesus Christ, where I hope we will meet and sing a new song and remain with the Lord forever, world without end. Amen. And my favorite is Dwight Lyman Moody, who said, one day you will read in the newspaper that Dwight Lyman Moody of Northridge, Massachusetts died. Don't believe a word of it. I'll have just passed through that mysterious door into my Savior's presence. That's what death is, right? Death is graduation. And we know this, it's not an accident. Right? It's not an accident. It's appointed unto man wants to die and then judgment. So last week it was Jim's time to go home to be with the Lord. It was a graduation to the presence of the Lord. Richard Baxter said that rebirth brings us into the kingdom of grace, and death brings us into the kingdom of glory. We know death is a time of sorrow, too. The Bible talks about that, doesn't mask that. If you can't sorrow when you're going to be separated from someone, then you really didn't like them a whole lot. I mean, you sorrow because you'll miss them, not because of where they are. We're not sorrowing for Jim. Jim's with the Lord. I mean, he's rejoicing. He's having the best Christmas he's ever had, ever. But we do sorrow. Those of you who, Scott and Joy, when David went to Chicago, you didn't have a party and say, he's finally gone. Well, you did have that, but forget that. It was like, we're separated from him, right? We won't see him again. But he's separated. There's something about that emptiness of separation, isn't there? And the saddest thing, by the way, is when we're separated from someone, we'll never see him again. Now, those who know Jesus, you'll see Jim again. We're separated for a period of time. Someone who doesn't know Jesus is not saying see you later, they're saying goodbye forever. So there is sorrow, but it is a time of blessing. Not necessarily for us all, remembering these things are a blessing, but it's a blessing for Jim. I mean, he's just had a hard time these last number of years. So it hasn't been easy. It's been a pain. He masked that pretty well, by the way. He would, Jim, how you doing? I'm doing okay. Okay, now stop lying. How you doing? But it's okay, you know. He's no pain, no sun, no Advil, no pain medicine, no anything in heaven. I mean, just pure delight and joy and fellowship with the Lord forever and ever. When Jesus said, I will come that you might have life and have abundantly, man, has he got that now? Right? Here's the neat thing, he's not going to miss any more calls in heaven. I have to tell the story. When I first came, I found out it was not. He was still umpiring. Now, he retired 3 years after he stopped umpiring. He was umpiring. And he was umpiring at Lakeland Christian, so I figured I'd better get out a little bit. It didn't matter how we got to Lakeland Christian. It was so bad that I'm going to lose my 100 anyway. And so he's umping the game, and he missed a couple of calls. So I said, hey, ump, right behind at the old field at LCS. Hey, ump, I took my glasses off. He said, hey, ump, hey, use these. You need some help. And he looked at me. This was his shining moment. He looked at me and he said, I'm not going to use those. Those obviously don't work. You can't even see the clock in the back of the section, right? One of the few times in my life I've been speechless was that moment. And that was a shining moment because he reminded me of that about 100 times. It was just absolutely perfect. But he's perfect. He's got that. Everything is just right. Talk about peace. Peace is shalom, is the way everything ought to be. That's what peace means, the way everything ought to be. See, what's unnatural is what's in this earth. What's natural is what's in heaven. See, we got to think. So that's the unnatural. No, that's the natural. We're in the unnatural. We're in what's tainted by sin. The natural
the eternal is what we will be then, see? He's, everything's natural. It's the way it ought to be. And we covet that for ourselves, and we're so glad for him. In the psalm, it reminds us, by the way, that life is viewed and judged by God. Right? It talks about, in verse 8, Moses says, you have set our iniquities before you, our secret sins in the light of your presence. You know everything. And that's what's stunning about the psalm. We die because of sin. That's what, right? The wages of sin is what? It's death. So we die because of sin. But we have eternal life because of Christ, because he is our life. And God sees everything. God saw everything about Jim. He knew everything about him. Every flaw he ever had, every sin he ever committed, every evil thought he ever had. And he absolutely loves him, loved him totally. Just like he loved some of you, and he knew more about you, and David pointed that out, he knew more about you than maybe you did, and he still loved you, didn't he? He knew your flaws, he knew the issues, he knew some of the things you did that may not have been right, but he loved you, and that's a good illustration of how God loves us. But what it says in the psalm is that he talks about the wrath of God coming down on sin, and everyone will experience that. Everyone will experience separation. And Jim experienced it, and he's with the Lord. We will experience it someday. We don't know when it will be. Right? We don't know when it will be. But we will experience it someday. Moses had experienced it. He had watched death. I mean, think of it. He led the children of Israel out into the wilderness. And for between 38 and 40 years, he watched millions of people die. Over 2.5 million people die. I mean, that's stunning when you think about it. There were people dying every day. There were 60,000 people dying a year under his tutelage. There were 5,500 people dying a month. There were over 1,000 people dying a week. There were 170 people dying a day. And he is their leader, and they're dying, and they're dying. And what he saw every day was this: the wages of sin is death. He saw it all the time. If you didn't catch it in the newspaper, it declared that 2020 was the most deadliest year America has ever faced. We have more people die now. We have more people. So obviously, 2019 was the deadliest year. And 2018 was the deadliest year. We have more people. But there are people dying all the time. That's because it's the wages of sin. And we remember that. 150,000 people die a day on our globe. 157,000 people die a day. I mean, think about that. That 7,000 people an hour die. That's about 125 people a minute die. So that would be about 7,000 people during this service that have died. Some of them will be with the Lord. Many of them won't. A bulk of them won't. And Jim had a heart that people would come to know Christ. You can see why that would be important. Because so many people are dying. And so Moses kind of recounts all that. And then he closes the psalm with just four requests. This is what I want to leave on our laps as we think about Jim, the challenge of Jim's life, and the challenge of his testimony. And as we remember that tonight, and there are four things that the psalmist says here. And the first thing he says is, help us to view life in light of eternity. Help us do that. Sometimes we do that when we know we're terminal, but let's live life like that all the time. Let's view life in light of eternity. That's what he says. He says, teach us to number our days. Why? That we may get a heart of wisdom. Return, O Lord. How long? Have pity on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we might rejoice and be glad all of our days. Help us realize it's just a short period of time. We have a number of days. Some people have put gumballs in a container on their shelf, one representing a week of their life, and figured if I live 80 years, there's so many gumballs I have left, and they'll take a gumball out a week and eat it. Well, that'll scare you, right? I guess, what do you do if you eat the last one? Jim would have 2 years of no gumballs. But the point, what it helps you is to understand, I got to view my life in light of eternity. I don't have as much time as I think. You'll get where we are quickly. I've said before, inside an old person, a young person, say, What happened? I'm still smart, at least I think I am. We can just, there's a lot of things that aren't true. But you know, I think I had my faculties, and all of a sudden, you know, the only stuff that works hurts. And how did I get here? It happens quickly. The second thing is, he says, I love what he says in verse 15, make us glad for as many days as you've afflicted us. Wait a minute, it's tough here. It's tough here. We can mask how tough it is, but even your moments of joy have been pending other moments behind it that you know are coming. How life works, right? When you get to heaven, it's not like that, but now it is. And so, but help us to bring life dry. Help us to really appreciate the goodness that we experience. This has been a tough year to experience that, right? To understand that. But as hard as 2020 has been, there have been many, many years in the history of the church that have been way harder than this. We're such a whippy culture that, you know, we think this is really tough. When you read through Fox's Book of Martyrs and you read what people went through, you say, wow, okay. But even if it's tough, so what? Can we rejoice when times are tough? Jim did. That's what I loved about him. When he was in pain and he was suffering and he didn't know how long his life, he just kept on being happy. That's crazy, isn't it? And that tells me it's possible. Help me bring life dry. Tim Hansen put it this way. Don't be bashful with life. Bite in. I think that. Pick up life with your fingers. Let the juice of life run down your chin. Life is ready and ripe now, wherever you are. You don't need a knife or a fork or a spoon or a napkin or a tablecloth, for there's no core, no stem, no rind or pit or seed or skin to throw away. So just take a big bite. I like that enthusiasm. I love people who live enthusiastically. That's one thing that David, you shared. You're always enthusiastic, right? And then, Lord, help us to bless us. Let your works be shown to your servants and your glorious power to their children. You talked about learning from your dad. You read the Bible. That was kind of how we did life. And help us recognize that you're at work. God's at work. God's been at work in your lives. A lot of the reason in God's a sovereign king, but a lot of things is the answer prayer of a man who loves you deeply. The answer to prayers of men who loved you deeply. You learn from that, right? You never stop praying. And never stop looking for God. How's God working? He's doing this, he's doing that. And with his kids, he was only the positive. Believe me, I know you did negative things, but he never told me one of them. It's always the positive. Yeah, they're doing this, they're doing that, you know. And David's team is, I mean, their high school team, I mean, yeah, they played Ohio State and killed them. I mean, that wasn't true. I mean, it was just like, he was tending toward a little hyperbole. But the point was is that he was always looking at the positive. I love that. Help us recognize, God, that you are at work. And then the last one, and I think this is so good. Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us and establish the work of our hands. Make our life significant. See, we can stand here and talk about Jim and say, well, he was kind of an anomaly. But Scott, I loved how you ended yours. We need more people like that. We know we need more people to stand up and be counted for God and live with enthusiasm. And Jim did that because of Jesus. He didn't do that because he was just a great guy. He did it because he loved Jesus. He did it because he trusted in Christ. He did it because Jesus lived for him and died on the cross for him and rose again for him. Jesus made a profound difference in his life. And there was a time in his life where he decided that he was going to make a difference by living for Christ. Again, even in the hospital in those last days, saying, I want these people to come to know Christ. That would be a time to think about your pain, wouldn't it? Your pain, your suffering, oh, I heard, give me some morphine. No, it's like, I want these people to know Jesus. Make my life significant for your good. His life has given us a challenge. His life has given us a challenge. And now it's time to step in the gap and meet that challenge. I mentioned in the beginning that Isaac Watts based his famous hymn on this psalm, so I'm going to quote from it, and then I'm going to pray. O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy past and our eternal home. Under the the shadow of thy throne, still may we dwell secure. Sufficient is thine arm alone, and our defense is sure. Before the hills in order stood, or earth received a frame, from everlasting thou art God, to endless years the same. Time, like an ever-rolling stream, bears all its sons away. They fly, forgotten as a dream dies, at the opening day. O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come. Be thou our guide, while life shall last, and then our eternal home. Father, we believe with all of our hearts that because of the finished work of Christ, that Jesus, God in the flesh, died on the cross for sin, rose again, ascended into heaven, that he died for sinners. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. He saved Jim. Jim put his faith in Jesus. We believe that what Jesus did on the cross was sufficient to save his soul. And it was. And he's experienced that in full, live relationship. Is eternal. We remember, Lord, when you said you're going to leave the disciples and they were in angst. And Jesus sensed their angst. And he said, stop letting your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it weren't so, I would tell you. But I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will return again and I will receive you to myself so that where I am, that's where you'll be also. Thomas curiously asked for directions. How should we know the way? And we all remember the words of Jesus, I am the way. No man comes to the Father except by me. Lord, we know Jim came to that point in his life where you became the way. He trusted you. And we're so encouraged this evening to know that he is with you, that he is the place of no pain, no suffering, no sorrow, full joy, absolute peace. Thank you for his life. Thank you for his investments in his children, in his grandchildren, in his great-grandchildren, in his dear wife. I pray for them. Many of these dear people in front of me right now, they've never experienced a Christmas without Jim, without his laugh, without him beating off the paper in the candy, without all the joyful experiences and remembrances I'll have. They'll be hopeful. I ask that you fill that with your love, and that they fill that with each other, with good remembrances, and that they remember the blessed hope, the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus. He's coming back. We will be with him someday, and there'll be this great reunion. We'll be together forever and forever. During this time of separation, may their thoughts of Jim be thoughts of encouragement and joy and happiness. Heaven has become sweeter to them, if it were possible. And I pray, Lord, that you would minister in that heart of sorrow that they're experiencing and help them look forward. We all look forward. Thank you for making everything possible. Thank you for loving us enough to come. And thank you for living perfectly, as we could expect only God to live in the flesh. And thank you for your willingness to die sacrificially on the cross, Jesus, to experience our death, our separation, that we should experience. You experienced it for us. And now we have hope, a confident expectation that someday we'll all be together in glory, rejoicing forever and ever. Until that time, will you teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom? Would you help us to look, to see you at work? Would you make our lives significant for your sake? So that when people gather around and remember us, we might hear some of the same things we heard tonight. And hear those words that I'm sure that Jim has already
finish off the service this evening is to sing this just the last verse of the hymn, How Great Thou Art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Let's sing that together, please.
And so